increasingly aware that all of the great money transactions, the flow of credit, all the important things that control people's personal and business lives were being concentrated into the hands of a small group of very powerful banks, insurance companies, and investment firms in Wall Street. And so there was a strong political movement to, and this is a phrase that you could read in the newspapers, to break the grip of the money trust. That was the slogan in those days. And if you go to the microfilm in the library, you can read editorial after editorial and speech after speech about the need to break the grip of the money trust. And so the purpose of the legislation, which was to be called the Federal Reserve Act, in the minds of the American people at least, the purpose was to break the grip of the money trust and to turn control of the monetary and banking system over to the American people, so that it wouldn't be used as a weapon against them. It would be used as a tool on their behalf. Well, as it turns out, that the men who wrote the Federal Reserve Act were the money trust. They were the very guys that the Federal Reserve Act supposedly was supposed to control and break their grip. Now, had it been known that the bill to break the grip of the money trust was written by the money trust, it would have been kind of obvious. And so they had to get off in secret, and they had to hammer out all the details of what the thing was supposed to be. Then they had to figure out why and how they could deceive the American people so that they would never know that it was written by the banks, the bankers and the money trust themselves. And they worked out the strategy of what to call it, for example. You see, there's another interesting little thing to it. At the time, many of the congressmen were really against the concept of the Federal Reserve system because it is what technically they call a central bank.
Yeah.
Central bank merely means a combination of political and commercial banking power whereby the banks create the nation's money.
Yeah.
It's an amazing thing. Well, they don't want to say, well, we got a system here whereby the banks are given a monopoly power over the nation's money. So they give it a mysterious name. They say central bank.
Yeah.
And nobody knows what that means, but you go to school like I did, and you remember the phrase central bank, and you answer the question on the exam, what kind of a system is this Federal Reserve system? And you say central bank, and you pass, you get your credit, and you get your diploma on the wall.
That's right.
And you walk out of school without having any idea whatsoever of what a central bank is.
Yeah, that's right. That's right.
So anyway, they had this problem in those days. They said, well, okay, we understand that the systems in Europe are central banks. And they said, the congressman now said, we don't want that here. This is America. We want our own unique institution. We don't want to copy those systems over there in Europe. So we don't want a central bank. And they didn't know what a central bank was, but they knew the phrase.
Yeah.
So the guys on Jekyll Island said, all right, gentlemen, how do we convince Congress to pass a law creating a central bank without calling it a central bank? And they discussed this. And they came up with a phrase, well, we'll call it something else. Let's call it federal. That makes it sound like it has something to do with the government.
Yeah.
Well, it doesn't. Except the government's going to pass it and say, okay, that's the only connection. And they said, let's add the word reserve. That makes it sound like there are reserves someplace, and there aren't. And then say, let's call it a system. Well, that's more important in those days than it would seem now, because remember, the goal of the voters, at least, was to break the grip of the money trust, which means to decentralize this power away from New York City. And so they wanted to create the illusion of a system of regional banks in all of these, you know, various states around the country. And they built these, the idea was to build these big mausoleum-type structures that looked very impressive, and people could go and look at them and say, golly, Maud, look at that. We got one of them here, right here in our local town.
That's right. Oh. Yeah.
So they created the illusion of a system,
yeah,
when in reality the thing was always designed to be concentrated in New York and controlled from New York. So they came up with this whole thing, Federal Reserve System, and then they added, in some cases, they added the word bank to it, and it's not a bank. So on every word, it's a deceptive concoction
yeah.
to create the illusion of something that is not accurate. And they talked about this on Jekyll Island.
Yeah, and even I know the day that the act was passed, pretty interesting, wasn't this like the day before Christmas or something like that?
Yes, a lot of the senators were going away on Christmas break, and there was, I'm not even sure there was a quorum there to vote for it, but they snuck it through. However, I don't make as big a deal out of that as some other analysts on it, because I think most of those senators and congressmen were already on record as saying that they were going to vote for it, and they recommended it and so forth. So had there been a full assembly there on that day, I'm pretty sure it still would have passed.
Okay, yeah. So, you know, should we drop a few names here maybe for people who aren't familiar, the guys who were at the meeting on Jekyll Island when this was, you know, being taken forward, do we have some names here? Morgan, maybe, I know a few. Are there any Rothschilds at the place? Lord Milner, maybe?
I've got the list right here,
sure.
And there were seven at that meeting. And the first one was Nelson W. Aldrich. He was next to the President of the United States. He was probably the most powerful political figure in Washington, D.C. He was the Republican whip, that's they call him. He was the lead of the Republican Party in the Senate. He was chairman of the National Monetary Commission, and that's the special body of Congress which was given the job of writing the Federal Reserve Act. So he was chairman of that.
Yeah.
He was a business associate of J.P. Morgan. He was the father-in-law to John D. Rockefeller, Jr.
Oh, really?
Yeah, they were all tied together, not only politically, but socially, and even by blood. The next guy, oh, by the way, they rode on a private railroad car from New Jersey, which is right across the river from New York. They got on the private railroad car at the railroad station there in New Jersey and went all the way down to Brunswick, Georgia. And that railroad car was owned by Nelson Aldrich. Okay, the next man there was Abraham Piatt Andrew. He was the Assistant Secretary of the United States Treasury at the time, but that doesn't really tell you much about him. His real connections were in banking. The reason he was Assistant Secretary of the Treasury is because he had powerful banking connections. And so he was really a banker. Number three, Frank A. Vanderlip was the president of the National City Bank of New York. That was the most powerful of all the banks at that time. And he represented William Rockefeller, which is the primary investor, and the international investment banking house of Kuhn, Loeb & Company. Number four was Henry P. Davison. He was the senior partner of the J.P. Morgan Company.